Hi, I'm your host Karim Rafa. Welcome to Golfing Conversations. I'm here with Daniel Faggella, CEO and founder of Emerge Artificial Intelligence Research. Daniel, thank you so much for coming today.
Of course, Karim. Good to meet you.
So can you tell us a bit more about what you do at Emerge and how you got into it?
Yeah, so I kind of a weird story. I started off in cognitive science. So I went to University of Pennsylvania, actually. See, all my ears are a little bit messed up. So I was training mixed martial arts fighters. That's actually what I did for a living in undergrad. Went to go study skill development for athletic training. And I'm at University of Pennsylvania. This is 2011. And I'm studying essentially neuroscience, human learning. So how do neurons and human brains generally, in terms of cognitive science and theory and in terms of neuroscience, come to learn and learn fast? And this is around the same time where there's whispers in the Ivy League academic breeze of machines doing this learning stuff. And so I became fascinated with AI, speaking and researching in AI kind of from that point. And as soon as I sold my e-commerce company, we got into what we do now with enterprises.
That's quite interesting. I mean, yeah, fundamentally, the building blocks around AI are very similar to the building blocks of how people learn, right?
Yeah, at least roughly. There's kind of correlates in terms of what machine learning is and its inspiration in biology. And I definitely started on the bio and cognitive side and then moved over.
We are here today at Interpol World. Can you tell me what we're trying to make of our 2 days here?
To sort of get a lot of these law enforcement folks up to speed on emerging tech is not easy. These are not academic labs at Cornell and Stanford. These are oftentimes places where, you know, we might not have a tremendous amount of tech talent. So being able to look at best practices rather than having everybody experiment on their own, I think is the real value. You not only need the academic sort of birthplace of the ideas, the initial use case, but you often need an organization or two to be the first ones, the guinea pigs, if you will, to take it on and see, does this really translate out of the lab? You know, 60, 70% of the time, the answer might be totally not, and we really have to go back to the drawing board. So this is a place where we not only can take it out of the lab, but can also see who has been the first guinea pigs and what lessons have they learned. And I think for law enforcement leaders that often don't have the budget to be a guinea pig, I think that's critical. So I think that's a value of what they're doing here.
Can you tell me more about what you do at Emerge and how that interacts with here with Interpol and, and the companies you've worked with, sorry?
Yep. So our work really is about mapping the capability space of AI. So we essentially cover the Fortune 500 innovations of AI in big sectors like banking, life sciences, defense, transportation. And we also track the AI vendor landscape, so all the startups in Silicon Valley and Israel and Montreal, you name it. So we kind of keep a pulse on these companies and these use cases and get a sense of not only what's possible, so having a full map of what could we do with AI, but what's probable, what's working, where's the traction.
How do you run that in-house? Is that, do you have a proprietary software that scans the market, or do you all do this manually?
Luckily we're a little bit better than spreadsheets at this point, but a lot of it is sort of not only mapping and tracking the companies, and some of that can be scraped, but it's also a lot of kind of tough work around interviewing and primary research. So interviewing compliance leaders in banking to see where they're using the tech, R&D leaders in pharma and seeing what they're doing, the people that have founded these companies. So there is the data scan and sweep side of things, but there's also the heavy lifting primary research side of things. And so we do thousands of interviews, and we have a really, really popular podcast in AI where we sort of air a lot of these.
I have to ask, is there anything particularly cool you can share with us that you've recently found or heard of?
Yeah, all right. Well, I've fortunately or unfortunately spent the last 6 months in banking. So we just completed probably our most in-depth report ever about the vendor landscape in banking. And I can tell you the following. Almost all conversational interface and chatbot work in banking today is hot air. So it's something to the tune of, I'm going to give you rough numbers here, something to the tune of 45% of the press releases from banks that have to do with AI, have to do with what customers can do and talk, they voice or chat. And as it turns out, something like 7% of the venture funding is actually going to those kinds of applications. And the companies in that space are in the very bottom quartile of credibility. In other words, the actual AI talent in a lot of these chatbot companies is garbage. They're not actually able to do real AI. So we find that in many sectors, this is a great example in banking, companies proliferate what they think will make them look good in the eyes of investors and customers, when in fact where the money's going, where the traction is, where the ROI is a totally different ballgame. And so that data was just a real heavy layering onto an insight that we already felt like we had, but the numbers told the story so much better. And I think all sectors have those hidden areas where people think it's hot in one space, but it's super not.
Now, I understand you must also be familiar with the risks out there around AI and what people are sort of scared of, so to speak.
I was at United Nations headquarters 3 months ago, and we actually took the woman who heads up UNICRI, so this is kind of the crime and justice wing of the United Nations. We took 1 minute of video. We mapped her face onto my wife's face, and we had her say and make facial expressions that she never actually said using 1 minute of data. And so these technologies are becoming more and more accessible. And it was pretty clear that it was a deep fake. We had 1 minute of data. But it's not going to be that long until, you know, 5 minutes of information from someone with a lot of, you know, videos out in the public sector can't be pretty well modeled. And I think that there are a lot of risks there. The main paradigm shift is the following. For five generations or so, audio, video, images are artifacts of real things. It's five generations of that. So your grandparents' parents would assume that
if it's
case.
If it's on photo, it's real.
Yeah, this is the case. The paradigm shift is that is shifting to whatever the creator wants it to be, as opposed to artifacts of things that happened. That's a big clunky shift there. I think, fortunately, we're not seeing a rife implementation of these technologies for deceptive purposes, but I don't think it's going to be terribly long until that does happen. So there's going to have to be regulatory stuff around punishments and policies there. There's going to have to be file formats that can be trusted versus ones that can't. There might be social media platforms that only work with certain file formats. Certainly television broadcasts, other media will probably want to stick to certain formats. But it's going to be a rat race where the bad guys and the good guys are going back and forth. So whatever ways we can detect it, someone's going to find ways around that.
You must have some sort of edge as well in knowing what's happening out there for investors and VCs that are investing in smaller companies like this, right? Not just the giants.
Yeah. Our advisory work a lot of the time is going to be bigger organizations, public or private sector. But our report, so I just mentioned the banking report, 20-30% in any given report that we produce is going to be by people who are investing in the space, who want to have a sense of what does the next 5 years look, what should we have in our portfolio, whether it's someone doing investing within an organization like a bank where they have an investment arm, or just pure VC private equity folks. So that's definitely a big part of the crowd that's into what we do.
In your experience and working with so many AI companies, do you think there's a particular framework that companies that invest in AI should abide to?
Yeah, when it comes to sort of principles, we use the Asimov's law analogy to solving sort of these deceptive AI technologies, of which Interpol is going to be covering in depth and I'll be speaking about. I think there's a lot of trials at what the set of rules should be, but I think it's really clear that those are in a teeter-totter early stage. I will say there are three real problems that need to be solved here. And I think any company asking themselves, what should we be doing to govern or deal with these, or country, will have to think through these three. So the first is going to be kind of at a technical level. Format-wise, media-wise, how are we going to prevent these technologies from sort of coming about in the first place? Or how will we understand sort of the validity of media through source X or source Y? So who's it coming from? What kind of format? The aspect of the format? The technical side is one thing. How do we discern? That's going to be a big deal. The second is what facets of sort of tinkering and programmatically generated content should be punishable in some way, or should we have to at least know about? So, hey, if tinkering beyond this level or in a way that could be described as such, it happens in a video, it needs to be disclosed in this way.
There's that one red line.
Yeah, right? So what are those we need to know or it has to be punished kinds of deals? Where's the line drawn in this programmatically generated world? All of those are gray. There's early ideas about that. I love that people are thinking about it, but, man, we don't know. And we really won't know until, the blank hits the fan, so to speak.
Yeah, until mistakes have been made and should be punished,
yep.
Or not, right?
Yep, and we're going to see a lot more media being tinkered with in a lot more new ways. As you can imagine, if rules are codified, somebody's going to find loopholes and other facets. Same with the technical. So the technical issues there, we have sort of the what needs to be disclosed or punished, and then we need to understand sort of how those things might be punished or might be regulated. So what kind of penalty is there for, X degree of tinkering. There's kind of prank level, and then there's messing with politics. Then there's, defaming someone or spreading, horrible rumors in some way, shape, or form. There's things that could affect the stock market in some way, shape, or form that we believe are intended to. Should there be gradients of punishment and regulation around those? Again, that's kind of issue number three. So these are kind of realms of problem that I think we need to continually develop frameworks for. And I really hope that Interpol, the UN, formats like that, will be able to come up with agreed upon frameworks that maybe larger countries can kind of agree on so that we can mutually lock in on how to prevent this from really messing with society. I think the whole dynamic of shifting from this media is an artifact of reality to it's super duper not anymore is massively disruptive. And to be able to have those frameworks in place, I think, would be crucial. So, three big issues. Hopefully somebody solves them. I think the next 2 years we'll have some good cracks at it.
Well, we're in the right place to figure this out.
That's true. It's true.
Well, thank you so much for coming today.
Of course.
Really appreciate taking the time. This was Coffee and Conversations, and we'll see you soon.